What's up, guys? Welcome back to my channel. My name is Sneaky, we're also known as Mom and All, and in this channel we are about thriving, especially in our personal finances. So in today's video, guys, I just want to lay the groundwork. I want to share with you guys the four steps that I'm following towards my becoming a millionaire mom, a millionaire, and basically attaining financial freedom. In the meantime, I'm exercising what I call financial wellness, which is basically making sure that I am financially sound to meet all my financial obligations, and that I'm planning for my future so that I can attain what they call financial freedom, where I don't need to worry about money, work for money, and all of those things. But for now, I really am enjoying the journey on financial wellness and basically getting from the point that I'm at now to the point where I want to be. And basically the point where I want to be is to be a millionaire, build generational wealth. So these are the four steps that I'm following, and I'm sharing them with you. You can decide, you can follow them, you cannot. And also share them with whoever signs up for my financial coaching, when we discuss and we dive into whichever aspect you are basically focusing on. Step number one is to build an emergency fund, 3 to 6 months of living expenses. And this is simple. It's basically having enough money saved up to cover, let's say, 3 or 6 months of not having any income at all and still survive. That is what an emergency fund is in terms of amount wise. And basically it's an insurance for yourself, so that if anything happens, should it hit the fan, then you're gonna be fine. And this comes in handy, guys, because I know, like, when I was pregnant with my daughter, I was still a trainee accountant, which means that I was on a contract basis and I didn't necessarily qualify for paid maternity leave, so I was on unpaid maternity leave. But for those I could have stayed 1 month and gone back if I was in a rush. But because I had an emergency fund in place, I could take the full 4 months of maternity leave and just pay myself from my own savings, instead of saying, oh, I can't even afford maternity leave, I'm going back to work and leaving my child while they're still very young. But that's the decision that I made, that I wanted to do. And then later on with my second child, then I was a full paid employee, so I could get the full 4 months, but I could now add on an additional month or two, saying, okay, I'll take unpaid leave, but I'll actually, like, pay myself from my own savings. So yeah, those are the benefits of having an emergency fund. It gives you options, and this is just for the motherhood stuff, but it can give you an option to say, you know what, I want to take unpaid leave for a few months to see if my business works out, and then if it doesn't work out, I go back to work. If it works out, then I continue with my business. So those are some of the risks that you can take if you have an emergency fund. So that's step number one, having an emergency fund, and it's crucial for me. And also when it comes to step number one, it's also important to have an emergency fund and a sinking fund. And the sinking fund is basically any other amount that you want to save for. So this emergency fund needs to kind of always be floating around 6 months of your living expenses, but your sinking fund is funds now for planned expenses, saying, okay, now in future I want to go on holiday, I want to, I don't know, do whatever. Then you save separately for that, and that's called a sinking fund. So don't confuse the two, because then you don't want to find yourself using your emergency fund for things that are not emergencies. And I suppose in a way my maternity leave wasn't an emergency, because obviously it was planned before, but basically I had access to saved money that could help me. Step number two that I've done that's helping me towards my journey, it's actually reducing my debt. I try not to take up much debt. I have a credit card, which if I do use, I pay it off at the end of the month, but I try not to use it anymore, because it really does kind of feels like 10 steps forward and then 10 steps back if now I'm using the credit card like that, like on the hamster wheel. But basically I reduced my debt, paid off my car in 3 years. I think there's a video on that on my channel. There's just different things that I did to reduce my debt, because I didn't want to be weighed down by debt. Because what happens is, if you've got debt, it means now you can't do certain things because you've got to service this debt. It means even if you do want to, I don't know, quit your job or take a little vacation, you can't, because there's this huge payment that you need to make sure that you pay every month. So those are just some of the things that actually are important, reducing your debt, because what happens is when you reduce your debt, it really frees up your cash flow. Then you can do other things with the cash. You can invest it and make a higher return on the money. And then when it comes to debt, there are two methods to pay off debt that I like to speak about: the avalanche method and the debt snowball method. And I've got these on my Money Mondays videos on Instagram. So if you're not following me, make sure that you follow me on Instagram. It's at @momandall_. And I do videos every Monday, Mom and All's Money Mondays, where we basically share about different financial chats. It's like short videos where I'll just share about money. So with regards to the two methods that I'm mentioning now, the avalanche method is basically paying off debt that has the highest interest rate first. And then the debt snowball method is basically paying off debt that has the lowest balance first. What helps with the snowball is that you end up paying off smaller debts quicker, whereas with the avalanche method, you kind of prevent incurring more interest. I prefer the snowball method because what happens is debt stays in your mind. It feels like a burden. It's like, oh, I still owe so-and-so, owe so-and-so, even if it's different amounts. So with the snowball, what happens is you get that effect of, I'm done with this, I'm done with that, because you're owing less and less people the more you pay off just the smaller balances first. Whereas if you still know you owe, it's like owing 10 people 110 rand each is stressful, but if you owe one person 100 rand, it's much easier. So what happens with the snowball is that you can just eliminate those people earlier on. And then now let's move on to step number three. So step number three that I'm also doing with in my financial journey is to actually have targeted long-term savings, which means having an education in place, educational savings for my children, and also retirement savings for myself. And I mentioned these two because those are, I feel, the long-term savings goals that are really important, because I need to make sure that my kids can afford higher education when they do reach that age of going to university. And what if they want to go overseas? What if they want to study something that's very expensive and is not offered like in the mainstream universities? I need to be able to afford that. So that's why then I've been saving for my children for their future studies. And then the other thing as well with regards to retirement, I actually should have started with this first, is that when I started working, I made sure that I opened a retirement annuity fund. And a retirement annuity fund is basically money that you pay every month, and then when you reach a retirement age, it will basically pay you every month so that you can live off of that money. So it's so important to supplement your pension. So that's what that RAF is for me. It's supplementing the pension that I have at work. And when I actually started working, I was on a contract basis, as I mentioned. So I didn't have a pension fund that I was contributing to, and my contract was 3 years. That's a very long time to not be contributing to your long-term pension. So that's why I started a retirement annuity fund on my own, with obviously a certain financial institution, using my financial advisor. So it's so important to reach out, find a financial advisor that will tailor make something that is specific for you, because you choose your own retirement age. Don't be caught out, guys, because they might choose the longest retirement age because they wanna, they're gonna get commissions in between. So just make sure that you choose the retirement age that is perfect for you, and then you just contribute to that. Plus you get tax savings in the terms of the amount that you contribute towards your retirement annuity fund actually reduces your taxable income. Then you end up paying less tax, because it's so important to have education for the kids and to also have retirement money, because when I'm older, I don't want to be black tax for my kids. Because that's what happens if you can't take care of yourself once you get to old age. It means someone else will have to take care of you, and that might mean your kids, and I don't want to place that burden on them. That's why I'm building up these reserves, so that at least my generation will be free. But my goal is obviously to build generational wealth, which leads me to step number four. And step number four is to invest and give. And because I'm building generational wealth, I want to invest. So I started also investing in different kinds of assets. So the different assets that I'm investing in are building my asset portfolio and are building my net worth, so that at the end of this financial journey, I've got assets to show I've got something that I've been working towards, and I'm not just on some, okay, I'm done working after 40 years or however long I decide to work. Now I'm eating my pension. Oh, the pension is not enough, because that's what happens. Our grandparents' age, especially for us in the Black community in the South African context, didn't have the opportunities that we have or that our parents had. So they are probably living off of the government grant. And then our parents are like, oh, we can get better jobs. We've got pensions. Oh, we're gonna be rich forever. Then they contribute towards those pensions with their employers, and then they don't save up anything else. Come retirement age, our parents are realizing that that pension is actually not enough to sustain their standard of living, because it's more than the government grant, but it's probably not as much as they were earning in their salaries. So that's what's happening. But now we are this generation that needs to say, okay, so my parents struggled in this way, in this way, in this way. My grandparents struggled in that way. How can I do better? I'm getting a pension. I've got a better opportunities. I'm getting a pension from my parents. I mean from my employer. I need to now supplement that. That's why then we've got that retirement annuity fund. Then you can have, then I also need to supplement that even further. Then you've got investment vehicles. You can buy properties, have rental income. Then you can build generational wealth, which for me is everything, because there's actually a verse in Proverbs 13 verse 22, which says that a good man leaves an inheritance for his children's children. And this always challenges me, because it says I must leave an inheritance, not just for my children, but for my children's children. And that's a huge challenge. It means that I need to make sure that, hey, I'm building serious assets that will outpay my children and then pay my children's children. So those are some of the things that I think are so important to look towards, especially if you want to have financial freedom and financial wellness and build your finances and go towards being a millionaire mom or a millionaire, whatever you are. So yeah, that is my journey, and that's just some of the things that I touch with when I also chat with my coaching clients, because we want to be in this journey together. You might find that you're still trying to build your emergency fund, or you're still trying to get out of debt. Then we do different strategies, or you want to do other things. It doesn't have to be just the ones that I've mentioned now, but it's so important to just have a clear path of where you're going and what are you doing, what steps are you doing to get there. But in a nutshell, these are the steps that I'm following. So if you enjoyed this video, make sure that you give it a thumbs up, and also subscribe to the channel for more videos, and also drop a comment down below so that I can address whatever questions you might have, and I will see you on the next one. Cheers, guys, and good luck on your financial wellness journey.